everybody, it's back. Tall, wide, and filled with nonsense. Why, it's Josh. And also, the Plinketto board is back. On this episode of Best of the Worst.
Well, Mike, we've got 10 movies to watch.
We're watching 10 movies?
Well, we've got 10 movies to choose from.
Oh, that's right.
Well, Mike, we've got 10 movies to choose from today. What do we have on the big board?
Well, oh dear God, it looks awful. Yeah. We have Invasion Force.
Mm-hmm. Keaton's Cop. Michael Keaton's Cop.
Crips with a Z. Terror Under the Hood. Is that about a car?
Yeah, probably.
Living to Die, which aren't we all? So I'm assuming that's a slice of life picture.
Perhaps.
Some people play for money, some people play for keeps.
I'd rather play for money.
Me too.
Space Raiders.
This one looks fun. I want to see this one.
Yeah, I used to see that box in the video store.
Yeah.
But I never watched it.
No. Well, why would you?
And next we have our player's choice block. So if the Plinketto ball falls and hits the player's choice box, you pick any video you want to watch.
Any movie anywhere?
No, it has to be one on the Plinketto board, unfortunately. Oh. Or else I would watch a video that's 30 seconds long.
I would watch a movie that
so that I could get out of here.
Oh, that's true. I'd watch a movie that I'd been meaning to watch for a while.
Well, that would also be a wise choice. Yeah. I would pick anything but something on here if I had a choice.
So.
What's next, Josh?
Next up is The Survivor.
Oh.
Evil holds the key to freedom, ellipses.
He crawled out of a hay barrel.
Yeah, and there's another one behind him.
What a terrible, terrible cover.
It's really awful.
And again, we have Death Stalker 2, which is for some reason always on the Plinketto board. I don't know why.
Are we sure that actually?
It might be glued onto. Oh,
no, it's not. Comes right off.
We have complete freedom of choice to remove this, but for some reason,
it shows up again. There it is. Next to that is Cyborg Soldier, which definitely is not related to any other movie that came out at any time. It is a perfectly original idea.
It is, yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh God, Ice Cream Man, which is Ron Howard's ball movement, starring as a child molesting ice cream man. I can't wait to watch that.
I have like a vague memory of this one. I don't know why I'd remember it.
Did it involve you being coaxed into the back of an ice cream truck?
Not by Clint Howard.
Okay. Okay. And lastly, Magic Kid. Well, I can't wait for the next 6 hours of my life. Josh, climb up on that ladder and let's pick our first videotape to watch on the Plinketto board, episode 3. All right, Josh, it's time to drop the ball and possibly pick a film that is good.
Yeah. We'll see.
Okay. Oh, Jesus, oh God. Oh no. Oh! Well, we picked The Survivor. Let's see if we'll survive The Survivor.
I'd like to apologize ahead of time. Okay. I have a bad feeling about this, but we'll see what happens.
Okay.
All right. So having gone over, we talked a little bit about the front with the terrible, terrible, terrible artwork and the legend, evil holds the key to freedom. Quote, thrilling intergalactic terror, close quote, no attribution. Somebody said this sometime about something. A courageous survivor of intergalactic wars is wrongly accused and sentenced to life in the post-nuclear penal colony, formerly known as Earth.
Have you any last words before sentence is carried out?
Don't do it.
Hello?
Hello. Is this thing gone?
Parlez-vous anglais?
Fuck yourself.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I never
see. Pussy.
Face. This brutal wasteland is ruled by Kyla, a bloodthirsty madman out to conquer the Federation.
Kyla is such a little girl's name.
It is.
Yeah, he's going to get made fun of. Maybe that's why he became an intergalactic tyrant. Years of bullying.
Oh, oh, oh.
Well, Mr. President, how nice of you to drop in.
Not that funny, guys.
Oh. But he wants to conquer the Federation, so this is a Star Trek.
Oh, all right.
You're gonna love this. All right. His terrorist group has kidnapped the leader of the free world, the Federation president, and holds him captive in a barbaric jungle fortress. Mankind's destiny will be under Kyla's tyrannical control unless the survivor can outmaneuver him, liberate the president, and escape this doomed planet. So I feel like we got some Escape from New York going on in here.
The premise of this sounds quite epic and grand scale. I don't doubt that there won't be any kind of budgetary issues.
No.
In terms of the quality of the final product. Yeah.
Certainly not by the graphics and pictures on the back. They definitely make it look like a very well-funded and well-thought-out film.
What do we get if we win?
Nothing.
It's a dumb question. Only 40 more minutes. I would expect nothing less from a movie I've never heard of.
Mm-hmm. It is presented in association with the Puerto Rico Investors Tax Credit.
Oh, they're my favorite film production company.
Mine too.
So okay. So it's a tax write-off.
Yeah.
It's a scam, essentially.
Oh, the full, actually, it's the Puerto Rico Investors Tax Credit Enhanced Film Fund. So yeah, it's a write-off. But it's got Richard Mull in it.
Oh, Bull?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, they got him.
What has he been up to? I guess being in that. Let's go meet the guys in the screening room and watch The Survivor.
We're not in the screening room, we're right here.
What? Get in the screening room.
Oh, right here, Mike.
We gotta, gosh,
I thought you guys were just nameless crew members.
Oh.
We don't have any crew members.
No.
We're just here.
Okay, let's go. Let's take the camera, we gotta go.
And cut.
Those poor natives.
Okay, we got kid.
Yeah, poor natives.
Yeah, they should not screw that.
Some random soldiers. Action man, teach mom.
Wait. Yeah, all those natives who we've befriended.
They're gonna do something. They're not gonna have all the natives get blown up. Something'll happen.
Sorry. They will.
No.
See, the bomb's not gonna go off or something. Or they're just gonna kill all the natives.
Kill them all.
Wow.
Yeah.
They don't give a fuck, do they?
Thanks, Mr. President. At least your little asshole grandson's okay.
Wrapped it up in a tight little bow.
Yep.
All right, Rich, it's time to pick another movie. So someone toss me the ball. Ball. Let's see what we get. All right, come on, Space Raiders. What, that Space Raiders? Yeah, yeah, oh, yeah, no, by the way. All right. We got a Keaton's Cop.
Yes.
Keaton's Cop.
Yes.
And Don Rickles?
Rickles,
my God.
It's an all-star cast.
Don Rickles? That's exciting. So we got Keaton's Cop.
Okay, so at first I was a little bit disappointed. I was going aiming for Space Raiders, mm-hmm. but then I noticed some things. I'm feeling a little bit more optimistic.
Right.
Hello, Luis. Bonjour. How are you, my friend? How are you? Here, Echo. Being one.
We have an all-star cast. We have Lee Majors, Abe Vigoda, and Don Rickles. And the other thing, that's a very positive sign, Canon video.
Ooh, damn.
So it's a Canon film, which is great.
Yes.
He ordered this when we weren't looking. Honest, Mike, we didn't know anything.
Yeah, Mike, we cut him off.
Was that before or after he ordered the silk shirts?
Keaton's Cop. When 70-year-old invalid Hyman Goldberg is killed by a hitman in a nursing home, Detective Mike Gable, Lee Majors, and his partner, Jake Barber, Don Rickles, get the call. So that's a promising start. That's
what? Why would you hire a hitman to murder an elderly person?
You just wait it out.
Just
really, have you ever been to an elderly home? Mm-hmm. Those things are fucking just death houses.
Do you think they just hired like a kindergartner to sneeze in there, and that's how?
I don't know. You just bribe that one cat that hangs out with the old person before they die. You ever hear about that one? They quickly discover that Goldberg was a mistake. The real target is Louis Keaton, Abe Vigoda, another resident of the home and a former mob member just released from prison. Mm. So they fucked up.
Yeah.
It's a movie about incompetent assassins that kill the wrong elderly person in an old folks' home.
This is beautiful. I love it already.
Look, Louis, this is no time to be stubborn.
What hotel are you taking me to?
It's a fine hotel. You know I can't tell you that for security.
Reluctantly, Keaton allows his old friend Barber to take him into protective custody, but takes an instant disliking to Gable. But when Barber is killed by the syndicate, Keaton teams with Gable to go after the murderers. In the tradition of such tongue-in-cheek police dramas as Midnight Run and Running Scared, ooh, Keaton's Cop delivers hilarity and action rolled into a white-knuckled case of mistaken identity. Well, that's not promising. Comedy? Bad comedy? Bad comedy.
Midnight Run is like
not funny. I'm worried now.
Schlocky action.
I'm worried.
Long distance. I want the number of Pete Costa. Costa with a K. K-O-S-T-A. He lives in the Irish section of town. What do you mean you don't have an Irish section? You keep looking, I'll wait.
No, I'll be fine. I mean, it's got Abe Vigoda. America's sweetheart, Abe Vigoda.
Have you ever heard of Keaton's Cop before? Probably wasn't his most memorable role, Jack.
Don Rickles is probably gonna roast some people.
Let's go find out what we got.
Like, oh, what? Hey, Vida.
Oh, you're my God.
Fatty, you're gonna, oh, you're so fat, you know. That's my Don Rickles impression.
All right, Mike, this is our final chance to save the evening.
Oh my gosh, I'm gonna try.
What are you rooting for?
Well, I'm hoping to get Crips.
Crips?
Or maybe Space Raiders. I feel like we need a little sci-fi or horror.
Okay.
Here we go. Oh God. No!
Oh,
yes!
Oh my God, it's Space Raiders!
I wanted Crips.
All right, Mike, you landed on Space Raiders. I think you need to read it now.
He's 10 years old, and they've taken him 10 million miles into space. Not happy about this. Not happy.
That's a fine premise for a science fiction film.
Security breach!
What?
What's that from? Is that a Battlestar Galactica?
The sound effect?
Yeah.
Star Wars trademark and Lucasfilm Limited program content.
What?
Artwork and photography copyright 1983. They must have a scene where he's watching Star Wars.
And they had to put it on the back of the box even.
They had to, yeah. I just wanted to see what film company made this.
I saw it's produced by Roger Corman.
Yeah. On a distant planet in a faraway future. also known as A Long Time Ago in a Galaxy Far, Far Away. A 10-year-old boy, the film's target audience, is about to become the unwitting captive of some ragtag intergalactic bandits.
Oh my god, this sounds like the most original movie ever.
This sounds boring. For many youngsters, this might be a problem. For brainy, resourceful Peter Tracton, it's the start of the greatest adventure a kid ever had. TV and film veteran... TV and film veteran Vince Edwards, The Victors and The Devil's Brigade.
I don't know any of these things.
These are made for TV movies. This is the biggest star they could get.
Yeah.
And young David Mendenhall, Over the Top.
Oh, is that the kid in Over the Top? Because it's Stallone. He has to arm wrestle for the custody of his child.
Oh, that's...
That's the child. Apparently, he lost the custody, and now he's forced to do shit like Space Raiders.
Now he was kidnapped by a band of intergalactic mercenaries.
This place is full of dangerous people. There's no telling what they would do to a little boy.
Ooh. It's a space cop alien.
There we
are. Yeah.
Oh my god!
It's Eggman.
Except the mouth moves. those are great.
Yeah.
They shift the fun into hyperdrive in the nimble, fast-paced science fiction tale Space Raiders. All the awesome Star Wars trademark style weaponry and robot ships of the sinister corporation. Wait, there's not a comma there. I guess they have robot ships.
Okay.
Oh, sorry,
I was just weaponry made robots. Of robots?
Yes, or a ship that is a robot.
Okay.
Are no match for these newfound allies who survive one narrow escape after another with courage and cleverness. Produced by Roger Corman, whose own space sagas from War of the Satellites to Battle Beyond the Stars range over 35 years of people-pleasing movies.
Of people-pleasing movies?
They forgot.
What it says?
Yeah, they
not
forgot.
Not crowd-pleasing or something a little more... People-pleasing sounds weird. It sounds like this was written by someone that doesn't have a lot of contact with humans.
No. And there's no quotation marks around anything here. Space Raiders is a fantasy film's delight. The whole family can enjoy. Well, that sucks.
Oh, I have a feeling. Could be wrong.
Walmart is setting something up, Mike.
Of course, kid is going to use that skill.
You don't think it's just a random scene?
I don't. And I'm just going to go ahead and predict that.
Not just filling in this 84 minutes.
Not just filler.
Have a beer, hot shot.
Goddamn rocks!
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
It's like,
goddamn.
Like beer, yeah!
Drinking beer, blowing shit up!
This kid's awesome! Yeah.
Rated PG.
Oh, fuck. Do you think they had to put the Star Wars credit at the bottom of that just simply because they mentioned the name Star Wars in the description?
So, yeah.
That's impressive.
This is gonna suck. Who put this on here? This was not part of the picks from yesterday.
Yeah, it was.
You snuck this on here.
I did not sneak
on there.
You know what I did sneak on there though was Invasion Force, and we didn't land on it. Look at this guy.
Look, you're a kid. You're no gunner.
I'm the only gunner you got.
Yeah, get him, kid. Kick their ass.
I can't. This is not like the rocks. This is a real ship!
And those are real lasers they're firing at us. The defense shield can't hold out much longer.
Point! Murder, kid! Murder!
Yeah! Kill him!
Yeah! Murder!
Yeah!
Now drink their blood!
He loves it!
Yeah!
He loves it!
He's got a taste for it.
So much violence.
He's got a taste for murder now, Mike.
Look!
Oh, yes.
Gross.
gets the hose.
Or it gets the hose again.
Yeah.
Signs of the Lambs. What a film.
I understand the references. I know all the references to the things.
Every last one of the references?
All of them.
All the most obscure references.
Which do you remember?
I can smell your c***. No, I don't.
That's from...
what's that from,
Mike? Star Trek 3, The Search for Spock.
What part
it's
of
the also in Silence of the Lambs.
Are you sure that wasn't the porn parody? Star Trek 3, The Search for Cock?
So today, we quite possibly watched two of the most mind-numbing, boring movies ever, and Space Raiders.
Yeah. We reached a level. We definitely reached a level.
We reached a level, but first on the docket, this is a tough responsibility. I've taken the reins because I don't feel like describing any of these movies. So we're going to see if Mike can remember The Survivor. Mike, tell us all about The Survivor. There's no reading the back of the box, Mike. You have to remember from memory.
I was trying to get some clues on the back. The Survivor was a thrilling intergalactic terror.
No, it wasn't. It was not. It was not that.
This is the Escape from New York movie with Space Plissken, the pun Rich Evans was so proud of that nobody cared about.
I liked it. I'm right here. Right here, Rich.
Thank you for your pity. This is basically Escape from Earth.
Yeah.
So where's Space Plissken?
Well, I think that's the guy who already landed there. He's gonna take control of protecting them.
He's going for the Space Plissken pun.
I like it, and I think it should go.
Snake Plissken, Space Plissken.
Oh.
It's a thing.
Earth in the future is a penal colony. They abandoned it 50 years ago. There's an opening scene where a guy who needs oxygen through his nose, because he's elderly.
Because Battlefield Earth.
Oh, maybe. Maybe the air in the spaceship was so bad he needed to breathe clean oxygen, blah, blah, blah. He sends man with Italian accent.
French
accent. He says, you're a criminal, go away on Earth, and blah, 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 disappear. And then the president of the United States, The president of space.
Yes.
President of the Federation.
President of Human Space Federation, yes.
Ironically played by Admiral Paris from Star Trek Voyager, and Tom Paris' father, who was in the Federation. Mm. There's a lot of connections here.
He is
on a big spaceship, and somebody reconnects power cables to make an explosion, and everybody escapes. Well, not everyone, 8 people. 500 people die.
Everyone important to the plot escapes.
On a space pod, and they land on Earth, and basically it's Survivor Man, aka French man with accent.
Action fellow.
Action man meets up with them, and they walk around the woods, and it's boring as fuck.
Yeah. Accurate description.
We can run down the cast real quick. You've got Action Man, Teach Mom, Small Child, President, Don Lovitz.
the lesser known younger brother of John Lovitz.
Yeah.
No, you look great. For a hologram.
Thanks, John Lovitz.
You look great.
Well, that's Don Lovitz.
Yeah, and Bull from Night Court.
Yes.
It plays a bad guy named Kesha?
Kyla.
Ooh.
A millennial girl who's 20 named Kyla, who's always on her phone. But instead it was an 8-foot tall man named Richard Mall.
Hairy fellow.
Yeah, and he is the leader of like basically a post-apocalyptic gang of warriors who live on Earth, who are criminals.
Oh God, this is so fucking boring!
And then there are like Aborigine people, which we thought, I speculated, might have been actual like natives.
Some of them had t-shirts on.
But then it seemed like there was like this like multiracial, multi-ethnic, multi-aged group of people who were...
Yeah, I couldn't tell you a whole lot about that part because that's right about when I fall asleep.
Josh did fall asleep.
Yeah, for a minute.
Screening.
But the MacGuffin in the film was a briefcase that the president had, and basically it would, you punch in a code and it would send for a rescue ship.
Yeah. Right.
And everyone wanted this thing to open it up. Richard Mall also had a nuclear warhead.
Mm-hmm. Sure, why not?
And a key to turn it on. And so at the end, it's like, you're gonna get the escape ship to come. Oh, Kesha, aka Richard Mall, the main villain, was also the son.
I can imagine people watching this.
Listen.
Well, that's how we felt when we watched the movie, guys.
Bull was coincidentally happened to be the son of the president and the father of the little boy who was on the ship, but his friend from Australia was a secret double agent who blew the ship up so that they could land so that Richard Mall could get the suitcase to send for an escape ship to come and get him off the planet with his band of...
Does YouTube keep track of when people stop watching videos?
Yes, they do. Yes, they do. And it's right about now.
I'm sorry.
Goodbye.
Have a nice night, everybody.
Thanks for watching Best of the Worst,
just
everybody.
Check out now. Wait for the second ad break. Then check out.
Put them both before this movie. Oh,
there's going to be 32 ad breaks in the first 4 minutes of the show.
Right,
so oh my God, there's so many ad breaks!
I never wanted it to be this way. You were an impatient kind. I was young.
Good night, everybody. Good night. Thanks. Thank you.
Martin Mull is a failed comedian. That's all I've got.
Martin Mull.
Or Martin Mull. Richard Mull. Whatever.
Martin Mull is a successful comedian.
I understand that.
He was Colonel Mustard.
I apologize to Martin Mull. But at least we have some kind of humor now because I missaid his name.
I think we should discuss how the action scenes are also boring. There's that scene where he encounters the big man, remember? And it's like the you know, the Indiana Jones fights the guy who's two times the size, and you know, you're supposed to root for. Yeah. And it was just so boring.
Well, it's because you're numbed out of your mind before that scene even takes place. You're already out of the film.
I mean, yes, but the thing is, all the action itself, which normally in a movie like this would be enough to snap us out of our reverie of just like, meh, and get like, oh, look, something's happening, was not even that good.
This movie makes a fight scene boring.
Yeah.
How does it do that? How does it accomplish this cinematic wonderment?
I mean, I'm not impressed with the Puerto Rico Investors Tax Credit Enhanced Film Fund very much either, because they didn't know what they were doing.
No, this was they needed to lose so much money before the end of the year.
And it still didn't work.
Exactly.
So their taxes would go down.
It still didn't work.
Yeah.
Well, no, the company who made this is Tax Haven was in Puerto Rico. Mm. It's a running open secret in Hollywood that every once in a while they'll make a larger budget movie that they know is going to flop so that it looks like the studio itself didn't make as much money, so they're in a lower tax bracket. That's what this is for.
I didn't necessarily realize that happened on an indie level.
It's like one of those things, if you don't do it, you look back on it and say, why didn't I do that?
We do get a mid-movie action sequence where Lady, who is a teacher or a mother...
Teacher mom.
Is forced to fight the native.
Oh, right.
And as it turns out, in a shocking twist, because she's a woman, she knows how to fight and kicks Adam Driver's ass.
Ooh!
Kick him in the crotch. He's just got a one claw. Kick him right in the junk. Kick him in the dick. Yes,
there you go.
Yep. Finally. See, that'll end it.
An early role from Adam Driver.
Yeah, very early Adam Driver role.
Adam Driver actually comes back later.
That's right.
And he saves her from one of the evil henchmen, and then he's like, we're even. and then he goes away.
And then they leave him behind.
And
to
then
get
a few hours later, he dies in a fiery nuclear explosion that kills literally everybody except for the protagonist.
Thanks, dog.
And the lady doesn't even say, should we get that guy?
No.
Hey, come with us.
No, debt is paid.
Oh, or they're just gonna kill all the natives.
Kill them all.
Wow.
Yeah.
Like they could have said, let's put the nuclear bomb on the ship. And then the ship will go off and everyone will be saved.
No.
We'll rebuild society down here. No. We will fix the earth.
No, they just wanted to save themselves. Typical white people. Teach mom, we call her Teach Mom because she was kind of taking care of the small boy, right?
We, is that we why? We weren't sure if she was supposed to be the kid's mother or just like his tutor or nanny, or we didn't any idea. It was never clear, it was never explained.
Yeah, his mother was never explained. No. We know through the film that Bull, you know, the psychopath on the planet, was his father.
Right.
But we're never told who his mother is. And his grandfather is Admiral Paris.
Probably just some woman he raped. I mean, he's kind of a mean guy.
Don't.
You have to assume.
We were so close to getting through this whole fucking episode.
We never said
that.
The R word. The whole day, Rich.
And you just spoiled it.
No, but you know what? You have to assume with any best of the worst movie that there is at very least implied rape. That's where I start the day. And hopefully it gets better. And it was. It was better. There was no rape until Rich brought us back down.
Want to see how it works?
You could say he was doing a little night courting.
Oh, you still have to cut that in right there.
So we definitely had trouble with the timeline of what Earth was doing in this movie. In terms of, like, it was abandoned, then it was a penal colony 50 years ago, then they abandoned it. Right. Someone says they abandoned it at some point. We're not really clear as to when it is, but we got, like, a context clue.
No one gives a shit.
God damn it, Rich.
I think we're focusing a little too much on the mechanics of the world, of the survivor, and let's talk about how the movie ends, so that we could get...
We did already.
Oh, what happened?
The nuclear blast?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So,
I'm sure it's not what you're used to, but under the circumstances, it's the best I could do.
Keaton's cop, who's gonna get Keaton's cop? Oh, Josh!
Oh, shit!
Tell us!
All right, so Keaton's cop is a semi-wacky police. Kind of procedural thing, in which Lee Majors and Don Rickles investigate a murder, but they kill the wrong person, and then Don Rickles gets killed, and Abe Vigoda, who was supposed to be the one that got killed, helps Lee Majors find out who the real killer was, I think.
Is the game over? I'm taking a pee.
Hey, Abe, we're still rolling!
Nope.
The main plot point of the movie is that Lee Majors has a superpower to locate every window in every building and push bad guys out of it.
Oh my god!
He threw him out the window?
Oh my god!
Oh my god!
Oh my god!
Well, for the first part of the movie.
Listen, yeah, he doesn't follow through.
No, it happens. It happens. He tries to push the one guy and then he gets stuck on the fire escape.
And then it never happens.
Oh, window? Window!
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 Yeah. Hey! Oh. He barely even went out!
Oh, wait! Oh, wait.
He's out, he's out, he's out.
Okay, oh, yeah. That counts. Okay, that counts. That counts.
Puts the torso out.
Technicality.
He has to lift the legs up now so he falls.
That damn fire escape ruined it.
Oh.
No, that was the one, his power ended. That was the last, like, it was the last one. That was all of the bad guy window juice he had.
Maybe it only regenerates if they hit the ground.
His power regenerates every time he fucks his dog.
Good old Blue.
God, Blue.
Good old Blue.
All right.
Or that woman.
So he has to fuck one of the dogs. It's not even true. She's not an unattractive
woman. No, she's fine. Just
trying to fit a joke
into
this rotten
movie. Rich is just saying
that
because they both can lick their own crotch.
I like your dog!
That was a deleted scene that Rich saw in the DVD version that he watched ahead of time.
It turns out Rich is an aficionado of Keaton's Cop.
Yeah. There's so many deleted scenes.
That was the porn parody, Clitoris Cop.
Keaton's crotch.
Keaton's cock.
Keaton's cock and Keaton's crotch. Two very different porn parodies.
Yeah. The one with all the gilfs is really off-putting. Yeah.
There's the woman licking her own crotch.
In the old folks' home?
In the old folks', yeah.
There's probably some kind of old folks' home porn out there somewhere.
Rich, I'm gonna tell you, I'm gonna say this on camera right now. I've had friends who have worked at old folks' homes. They masturbate so much.
So much. Your friends that work at the old folks' home?
The old folks. The old folks.
I thought you're renting out your friends.
Well, they might too. They might too. I'm not judging that. I'm not judging any of it. But old people are just like, they're just jacking and jilling all day long.
So back to Keaton's crotch.
All right, so in Keaton's crotch, Lee Majors has a lot of paunch. And is
well, they don't let us see his paunch.
Lee Majors has a paunch-free contract.
He gets close.
That was one of my favorite parts of the movie. It was all the artful ways they hid Lee Majors's paunch.
Bless him.
So Lee Majors made sure to cover his paunch. Always the tasteful cutaway, so we didn't get to see that gut.
I don't really understand why this movie exists.
We had speculated, because there's a lot of old people in film.
Yeah.
That it's a way for people not to get kicked out of SAG because it's been too long since they've been in a motion picture.
Because it's a yearly thing, you were saying?
Yeah, well, they have a certain limitation. If you're not in a movie for so long, you get kicked out of the guild and then you lose any benefits that you obtain. And so when you're elderly, there's not a lot of roles out there. So perhaps they all pool their resources and once a year, all the old folks make one movie that they can all act in.
Oh, that don't get down on the old, Jack. You're gonna be one of them.
There's roles for people of all ages. From
you're gonna be an old someday.
No, I'll be dead way before then.
Die young and leave a great looking corpse.
Have you seen
Man with Children?
Have you read our comments? I'm not gonna make it two more weeks.
Because he got that diabetes.
Yeah. That diabetes.
Yeah, I always say you have diabetes, and everyone believes it. Yeah. So I'm going to keep saying it.
Well, they think he has diabetes. They think you're an alcoholic. Mm. It's just.
Yeah, I don't know why they would think that. I mean, really, it's weird.
It's pretty crazy. It's weird. I can't believe that anyone would think that Mike is an alcoholic. I mean,
you have a little alcohol.
Who are these people? What would they like? Why would that even be a thing?
It's just. Yes. I don't know why they would think that.
It's just. Yes.
I don't know why they would think that.
It's just. Yes.
I don't know why they would think that. Well, I'd like to address your point, which was probably the best point of our Keaton's Cop discussion, was what the fuck was the point of this movie?
Yeah.
Because one, it was not a good action movie.
No.
Wait! I have no idea what just happened.
It was not funny. It was not a comedy. Nope. We're promised comedy because.
Maybe gray around the balls, but there's still a home run or two in the back.
Oh, don't ever say that again.
Oh God, I don't want to hear about your balls, Abe Vigoda.
I want to park on that for a second. Don Rickles makes no jokes in this film. Don Rickles, internationally known comedian, makes no jokes in this fucking movie.
Don Rickles is an extremely funny man.
Excessively.
Yeah, and he does no jokes. And he gets shot in the back with a shotgun and dies.
I feel like he's trying to do like his Oscar role like in that last leg. He's just like, I'm sorry.
Sorry, kid. I crapped out on you.
So this is made by Canon. I have a theory that Menachem Golem, they just wanted to make an action movie, and they said, we need stars.
Yeah.
And then they just found the three names they could get.
Whoever was available that
Don Rickles, he's a star. Put him in a film.
I have
Lee Majors, I know that name. Put him in a film.
Yeah. $6 million man. Yes, many done.
Hey, Vigoda, he's TV's fish. Everyone loves him.
Every year he used to pick the other.
What?
Oh,
holy shit. Oh my God!
Well, that was that.
What was the point of that scene?
They needed an explosion.
Oh no! Oh my God!
Whoa!
Wait till he gets in the car! Oh my God!
That's actually Abe Vigoda. We only get one take.
We had fun with the movie by coming up with all of Abe Vigoda's weird stipulations for starring in the film.
No, Abe, you have to remember to say words. I need another ice cream bar. If you want words, that's going to cost you one ice cream bar. bribe him with ice cream to save
his life. I want to go on the ferry. Make a scene on the ferry.
Abe Vigoda kept being in very weird situations that seemed to benefit Abe Vigoda.
Yeah, and not do anything for the film. I want oysters. We need a scene where I eat oysters.
There's the famous taxi scene where Abe Vigoda needs to get his hair cut, which is unrelated to the film. We think he's going to talk to a mafia informant, but really, he just needed his haircut.
And he just wants to go around the block
after
that.
Lee Majors is in the car waiting, and Abe Vigoda gets his haircut, and he gets in a cab, and Lee Majors is like, oh, fuck.
Oh, fuck. Keaton, what the hell are you doing?
I won't be in your film unless I can get a haircut and take a short taxi ride.
I need a taxi ride. And then they go to this thing that looks like an ice cream stand, but somehow they have oysters.
Yeah, there's no oysters, but then there's also an ice cream bar.
Ice cream, and Abe Vigoda gets oysters. Yeah. And then, they park the car.
Yeah.
Lee Majors gets out, he walks through the restaurant, they hear him pans him through the restaurant, he comes outside, and he goes over and uses the payphone, and Abe Vigoda comes through, and he sits down, and immediately a waitress comes up with oysters.
The first instant is the most blatant, where it's just Lee Majors and Abe Vigoda, and they get on a ferry.
Oh yeah.
And then they get out of the car, and they're riding on the ferry to an island or to the mainland or whatever, and Abe Vigoda just goes, I like riding the ferries.
But the only reason they're on a ferry is because Abe Vigoda wanted a ferry ride.
Well, he had to get his car over to this other part of town.
No, it's explicit in the dialogue. He says at the very end, so why are we going here? I told you, I like ferries. Putting your car on a boat is a lot of fun. I don't know if you guys have tried it. If you have bodies of water near you. We do.
Sure, yeah, we got the Michigan.
Hey, you wanna go over to Michigan?
It's called Lake Michigan.
No, but what's the ferry called that takes us over to Michigan? It's the Lakefront Express. Is
it? The Unsinkable Express.
The
one that sunk?
Yeah.
And that's how you get to the island where the zombies are.
Yeah, the Milwaukee Island, as seen in Dawn of the Dead.
Yeah.
The Zack Snyder film.
Yeah. The tropical Milwaukee Island.
Yeah, with the palm trees and the zombies.
They always, always get the Midwest right in films.
100%.
Have they ever made the mistake of mountains being in the background, just out of curiosity?
Probably.
Fucking Christmas Vacation.
Oh.
With Chevy Chase, when they're like, Illinois license plate, we're gonna go get a tree. There's like fucking Rocky Mountains in the background.
All in all, the most confusing part, because you know, like it's pretty standard, but Lee Major's relationship with the nurse. Is something I would like to point out because they're in an ordeal. Lee Majors saves the nurse and Abe Vigoda after Don Rickles gets shot.
Yep.
Lee Majors drops the nurse off at her apartment. Cut to.
That's when she kisses him.
She kisses him. Cut to they are lovingly walking down the beach and apparently in a relationship.
Yeah. I feel like we missed a lot there.
Then they presumably have sex. And she never leaves his house again.
That's true.
She's been claimed by Lee Majors.
she shows up with the key again, and his kid is there, just hanging out with the dog.
Yeah. Do you remember when Lee Majors assaulted his ex-wife's boyfriend and threw him out a window and nearly killed him
window.
For like no reason?
That's fine.
I do remember that.
There you go, Rich. Rich is just leaving. All right, bye.
All right. And bye, Rich.
I don't know why.
He's going to take a dump in his Sony swag bag.
Morning, Lieutenant.
Keaton's at the gal bed. Get him out of here.
What the hell is he doing at the gal bed?
Get over there right away. Right away, you understand? The guy is up to $5,400.
$400 what it stakes?
He's got rice pudding. I don't know what the hell he's doing with it.
He's nuts. He sent the infant for mustard. You understand?
All right, I'm on my way. I'll be there in a half hour.
So the emergency is your witness is spending too much money?
Yep.
Just cut him off.
I'm gonna be late. Really long.
I gotta stop Abe Vigoda from ordering steak.
That's what's happening.
Wonderful.
Hey, we're here, we're back, and our last movie, the savior of this particular evening, was Space Raiders. Rich Evans.
This is actually a joy for me because for once I actually understand what happened in the film.
I wanted to give you a little breather here.
No. Space Raiders is about a band of like filthy space criminals, and they attack like a little corporate space base to rob stuff, and a little kid stows away aboard the ship they steal, and they go on an adventure with the kid where they learn to like the kid, and we gotta bring this kid back home, but things keep happening to keep them from getting the kid back home, and then everyone dies, like Rogue One, so I guess it's the best movie that was ever fucking made.
Oh. Wait, what? What?
So, does Rogue One have that alien prostitute lady?
Space prostitute lady looks a lot better than Uncanny Valley Tarkin.
Rich is throwing shade at Rogue One.
Oh no.
Rich, do you know what throwing shade means?
What does that mean in the hip lingo, Mike? What does that mean? That sounds nice. It's like a sunny day out. Have some shade. Ah, oh, thanks, dude.
Hey, now I'm comfortable in this warm weather.
Continue, please.
Step one, this is produced by Roger Corman, who knows how to make a cheap, sufficient movie. And I think actually this was past sufficient. Like we
really knows how to use a low budget.
Yeah, absolutely. And we were marveling at some of like the matte paintings and the miniatures. And I don't know where he necessarily, you know, bought those. I don't necessarily think that he made them himself, but they're really good.
He understands that, like, you don't go too cheap on the music.
Yes.
We'll get to the music later, but you get some half-decent music.
Yep.
And then you need to wow them with some of, like, the set-type stuff. Like, you get some really nice models for the ships.
You do that.
Some alien masks that really wow you.
Yeah.
But every now and then, like, you see, like, an office chair by a table. Like, I got a chair in the office, there you go.
Yeah.
But there's enough quality that you buy into the world.
They might, you know, use the same hallway set a few times. They might use the same bedroom set a few times.
But the idea is that the story and the actors will be good enough to distract you from that petty bullshit.
The opening of this movie could have gone very badly. The opening of the movie takes place in like a steel factory. But before you get to the steel factory there, there's the establishing shot, this amazing matte painting establishing shot with like a spaceship and space stuff. And then once you cut into the factory, you're in it.
Yeah, you're ready to believe it.
And by the time it's wearing on you, oh wait, we're just in a fucking steel mill. And then we're out of there.
By that point, yeah, we're done.
They distract you with the stop motion bug.
Yeah.
What's that? Oh, hey, what's that?
The little buggy.
Yeah, who had no payoff, but whatever.
The bug of no payoff, yeah.
It was metaphorical. The kid takes care of the bug, and the space raiders take care of the kid.
Oh, and then you have to let it go and do its own thing.
The beer can was the spaceship at the end. I think.
That, you know what? That actually, I could see that being true.
Oh!
7 o'clock. What am I, blind?
Kid, you're in my seat.
That was it.
Just don't sit in any of the chairs. They've hurt someone.
He hasn't been. They've just been pushing him around.
Try and find the dead guy's chair.
Excuse me.
They don't walk around in a forest preserve that's supposed to pass for an alien planet for 45 minutes.
Every once in a while, they land in California, but that's fine.
Sure. That's fine.
Well, you gotta blow up the egg factory.
Yeah.
That's just part of it.
You gotta fight the Gorn.
They go to this like space dock thing that's like, you know, there's like a Quark's bar in there, and there's like, it's like a hotel room, and it's like a filthy like spaceport.
Yeah.
And then they leave.
Yeah.
And they go a couple other places, but then they come back.
Yeah.
So they vary up all their locations to keep it visually interesting.
Yeah,
the whole time. There's a charming quality to it.
Yeah.
And an appreciation, because we watch it. And you know, it's a knockoff of Star Wars.
Oh my god! Oh my god!
surgical gloves.
Just
right there. That other one was surgical gloves. Yes.
It's a cash-in.
Yeah.
We have a little kid. A little kid in the Star Wars world. Come on, everybody, come watch. It's like a carnival barker. Come on over.
It's not though a direct one-to-one knockoff though. It's not like we're ripping off Aliens and we got an alien monster running around in a spaceship.
Not at all.
It's similar in like the style of like the props, there's a grittiness to it that you got in the Star Wars films. Mm-hmm. But story-wise, it's not like you got it, and then Luke learns how to use Duke learns how to use the Force. After Moby Bon Popobi teaches him the ways of the Judai.
It wasn't a knockoff in that sense. If you're making a low budget ripoff movie, they did an A+ job of making a low budget ripoff movie, almost to where it barely crossed the line into its own thing, but just fell short.
Yeah.
Almost a real movie, which is high praise on Best of the Worst.
Oh my god!
We're rogue running it.
You know what? It's also endearing. Like I could see watching this as a kid. There's that whole sequence with kid, whatever his name is,
child
and Hawk, where like Hawk is like giving him beer to drink and having him.
This movie is rated very highly amongst pedophiles.
Leave me alone, kid. I don't want to get molested.
Mike, were you touched?
You can cut away now. Please cut away now.
Yeah, it was the bad touch, but you know, child to man, bad touch.
So the music, I think we could agree, is quality music.
Absolutely.
For a low budget production, which you don't usually see.
High quality.
We noticed something about it as fans of a certain franchise that
Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure?
No.
Well, surprisingly, the musical composer of Space Raiders, a B movie made by Roger Corman, was the famous James Horner.
Yeah.
And if you don't know who James Horner is, he composed music for many films, the Star Trek films.
But notably.
Notably.
Star Trek 2 and 3.
Mm-hmm. People on 50 colonized planets are waiting for shipments, and we've got robots sitting on their hands. We're the biggest corporation in the galaxy. Yeah. We can at least get a shipment off on time.
It sounds like Star Trek 3 music. Yes, and there's a lot of music that Rich and I noticed was very similar to Star Trek III, The Search for Spock.
Even I noticed. Like, the feel is very similar.
These films were made right around the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah, if James Horner wasn't dead, we'd call him out on plagiarizing himself. I guess we still are, but.
Well, it's not necessarily plagiarism, but it feels like offcuts. Like rough tracks and demos and kind of, although, which is not to say the quality of recording, because it's definitely like fully orchestrated.
Yeah.
But it's just kind of like development of ideas, fresh and new, and then we're able to be developed more to get into the Star Trek
or
stuff.
Or I have this whole composition, I'm gonna tweak a couple notes here and there and give it to you.
Sure. Roger Corman is a smart man, and he would be smarter enough to say, you know, you did that Star Trek film, do you have any like rough cuts you can give me that I can use?
Yeah.
Don't believe us? Here's a comparison right now.
And hit it.
Say this is just a wise use of table scraps that probably weren't going to be used anyway. The lesson to come away with Space Raiders, if you're doing a low budget science fiction film,
don't go into the forest preserve and pretend that's some kind of magical, fantastic setting.
Yes.
It looks like a fucking forest preserve and your movie will be awful.
We can take them.
Sure. Get the fuck out of my seat! That's my seat!
Oh my God, I get to sit there!
Okay, so we watched three movies today. Yeah. Mike, what is your pick for best of the worst?
Well, I'm sure everyone else will probably end up agreeing. Space Raiders is best of the worst. They take a low-budget B-movie and make something out of it. Yeah. When these two people failed. So Space Raiders is my pick for best of the worst.
I echo everything you say. Space Raider, you know what else Space Raider brought? A little heart yeah. to it. Teeny bit of heart, a lot of alien prosthetics, and laser guns with no lasers, just kind of sparks, but I'll take it.
Yeah, firecracker guns.
That's probably a more realistic laser, Jack. Oh, yeah. This is a fucking efficient film. It's so efficient that I am going to skip over Josh and nominate this as my pick for best of the worst.
But I think there's a Roger Corman flair that goes beyond efficiency, which is it actually tells a story, and there are characters in it. Sometimes they're a little goofy. Sometimes
you understand what's happening and why it's happening.
It's all simplistic, but it has that element.
And the efficiency, which is just that the budget goes where it's supposed to. The miniatures and the matte paintings are gorgeous. Everybody in, like, acting wise, like, there's some terrible acting in this one, even though there are some reliable character actors in this one. On and off, you know, you can depend on Abe Vigoda and Don Rickles, that's fine.
You have some major talent there, is the thing.
And it's kind of just fluffed off.
No pun intended.
Oh. That was a $6 million comment.
That was a $7 million fail.
I fucked it up, God damn it.
No, you didn't.
You know what? You know what?
No, you didn't.
You know, I successfully said Don Rickles.
You did. You did. I was here for it. You guys were talking about whatever, but he successfully said Don Rickles, thought he'd gotten it wrong, and I was there to back him up and say no.
What, have you always been saying Don Pickles? Don Wrinkles?
No, Don Lovitz.
Space Raiders, you go, girl.
Yeah!
But see, that's the hallmark of Roger Corman movies, is that everybody, it seems like a lot of people, like throughout the Roger Corman movies, people like are trying, and they really are giving their all to a movie that doesn't necessarily